Hi, I'm Hannah.
Hi, I'm Abbi.
And this is Spilling Ink.
The Inkspill podcast.
We are coming to you today with episode 3.
Yep.
We've made it to episode 3.
I know, nearly a full season.
It's amazing. Mm-hmm. And it's actually quite exciting because last night was our second Inkspill of the year.
It was.
So we got to actually...
That gives away when we've recorded it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, cryptic stuff. I think I was telling everyone about it last night. Like, tomorrow morning, me and Abbi are recording.
We were like, please be nice to us.
But I think, it was really nice to go around and get a little bit of feedback. It's the first time we've done an Inkspill where people have heard the podcast.
Yeah. The last Inkspill was the day we released the introductory episode back in January. Yeah. So it's the first time I've actually got to talk to our local community, our Inkspillers.
Yeah, and kind of get their feedback on it. I think that's it. We want to make sure that we're doing this for others as well. So it's quite nice to get their opinions. And it felt good. And it was nice to have numbers back up again last night at Inkspill because...
Yes, January was quiet.
December was quiet, and inevitably so. It's always...
We accidentally booked it on everyone's Christmas party night. Yeah. So and then everyone was very apologetic.
Yeah, and the dreaded flus that come at that time of year. So yeah. It was just really nice. Last night felt really restorative for me, having full room, back together, got the gang back together.
Yeah.
And it was really nice. And we had a really full open mic, and we were just talking about
18 people on the open mic?
Yeah.
It's a lot.
Really, yeah, huge amount of people there last night. And I think that's always really nice for us to see that people feel confident enough to get up there and perform. It just makes me feel better about the community we've built, that people do feel so comfortable and
absolutely
secure there.
Yeah, and we had quite a number of new faces, which is always nice to see.
Yeah.
It's really reassuring that I know Inkspill 20 is in April, which is insane. So we've done this was number 18, mm-hmm. and we're still getting healthy numbers.
We are.
And friendly faces.
It's fantastic.
Yeah,
so
we're great.
Yeah, we're feeling good after last night, I think. And very excited that we're going to have our second guest today, aren't we?
We are. But before we get there, shall we talk about our creative projects?
Oh, well, I guess we should.
that thing that looms large over us.
Yeah. I will complete honesty. It's been a week, obviously, since we last met and we discussed this. And I have been very busy. I always think when it gets to half term, I'm going to have a golden week to do things and to write. Doesn't happen. Mm. I've just been here, there and everywhere, running around like a crazy lady. And as well, annoyingly, I got the inspirations to start writing a play. So
what?
And I
was starting, where did that come from?
I don't know, but do you know when you kind of get these waves of inspiration, you kind of think, okay, I could let that pass me by, or I could just, whilst I'm feeling quite inspired,
literally ride the wave.
Get on with it. Yeah, yeah.
Fair play.
So I rode the wave, and it's funny because I keep getting my husband Ben to act it out with me so I can see how it sounds. Which, if you know Ben at all, it's his worst nightmare. But
yeah,
I mean,
but he loves you.
He does, yes, exactly. So, I mean, it's got to be done. So he's been very supportive with that. So my creative project this week has been...
Neglected.
But I have actually done the creative tasks that we set last week.
Oh, fantastic.
Tell me about you. Your week, how has it been in terms of writing?
What a great question. I'm very much on YouTube. They can see the wide-eyed panic in my eyes.
Yeah, I was about to say, you look panicked. I've got
Yeah, I mean, I have had I did 3 poetry events this week.
You did.
We went to a local one, Grand Plans, over in Linthwaite, which was lovely. And then I was in the Mind Over Slammer Poetry Slam Leeds Heat on Wednesday. Was Wednesday Valentine's Day?
It was, yeah.
Wednesday was Valentine's Day. On Wednesday. It was a fantastic event and just such a good quality of poetry. Yeah. Wonderful people, really vibey, learnt a lot. And had a fantastic time. And then we had Inkspill last night on Friday. So unsurprisingly, I will also be honest, which is... a really important component of this podcast is we're not going to pretend to have done work and we haven't, because we've been busy. I haven't actually worked on my project, but I have also done the creative tasks, but in slightly more creative ways.
Okay, like that.
Yeah. So I have the creative project I want to work on for this podcast is a poetry collection. But the work that I shared this week was the novel that I've been working on. I officially cost 63,000 words.
Gosh, that is shooting up.
It is. The jump is because I'm using a lot of the first draft now and I'm just kind of rewriting it rather than before I was adding in quite big, massive plot components that were missing.
Yeah.
And I shared that with a lovely friend who is just absolutely powering through the second draft. He's just like, cool, I finished it. Where's the next one? I'm just like, give me a second.
That's so good that you've got such an avid and enthusiastic reader.
Yeah, it is. It makes such a difference because between my friend and my partner, Alex, It's just like the driving force of this project. Like it wouldn't exist without either of them. And it's been such a huge component to like it happening. Mm-hmm. So I've shared my work.
That was the goal that Faye kind of
inspired
set for us.
Yeah.
So I think being collaborative and sharing your work with others and getting some feedback is a really key thing to do. Mm-hmm. And so well done, you have done that. I also did it. I spoke to my mum. My mum came around this week, which was
lovely.
Nice. Because I'm originally from Wakefield, but I moved to Hebden Bridge, so I'm not ages
miles
away, but I am a good, you know, it takes a good journey to get to me now. So I don't really get to see my family that often. So it was really nice in the half term. She booked a holiday day and came up to see me.
Oh, lovely.
And we had a good old catch up, and I really wanted to pick her brains because my novel is about the place that I grew up in, Castleford. Mm. And I moved away from there when I was about, well, I think it was about 5 when I moved away, but obviously my family is still there, so I visit all the time.
Yeah.
But then, sorry to kind of put her down on it so early, but then everyone has died now, all my family in Castleford, they've all kind of died out. From old age, you know, it does kind of happen, and everyone did very much leave Castleford quite young.
Mm.
So all the family that we had there has died down. So I'm writing this novel about a place that actually I'm picking on memories from a good few years back now. And when I do visit, it is quite fleeting. So it was nice to sit down with her, show her the novel so far, read her some of the kind of things that I've been working on, and just see if it resonated with her. And she said it really did, and she gave me some really constructive feedback as well. So again, I just think I cannot stress enough, share your work with others.
Yes.
Because putting yourself out there and saying, I'm working on a book, I'm a writer, I'm taking this seriously, it's the best thing you can do. It gives you that confidence, doesn't it?
Well, even thinking back to last night's ink spill, which is February's ink spill, we had a number of new faces who were like, we haven't brought anything, we've just, so for anyone who is just joining us, Inkspill is our poetry night. We're in Huddersfield. It's half workshop, half open mic.
It is.
And some of the new people that joined us just came for the workshop and were like, we have new work from this workshop that we would like to share. And we were absolutely.
I know. And I just love it when people kind of feel confident and inspired enough to do that.
Yeah.
Even though it's not polished, they've never actually said it out loud.
Nope.
Just to get up in front of everyone and perform it.
And it was beautiful work. There's so many beautiful pieces last night. Phenomenal.
We had some people, I think, who were just going to be there to spectate, but in actual fact, they felt so inspired by the night that they got off. It was fun. Oh, it's really nice.
It's reassuring that we're doing the right thing.
It absolutely is, yeah. So what were the other things that we said last week? So collaborative work.
And we had pantsers and planners.
Yes, exactly. So for my planner activity, it was mapping out the skeleton of your work and kind of planning what you're going to put in each chapter.
And setting sustainable goals.
Yes, sustainable writing goals. I would say I did that, actually. So I'm here saying I didn't do anything on my novel. I rewrote a description of Castleford based on the conversation I had with my mum. Because I was trying to capture, we grew up in it was a place called Smallthorne Grove, and it was just row after row of terraced houses. Mm. And they were the kind of terraced
Collery
houses.
Collery kind of housing.
Yeah, and it was where you had people attached to all sides of you. So there were people to the left and right of us and at the back of us. And we all kind of shared gardens and ginnels. And it was, it was very communal in that sense. And I think I wanted to make sure I really captured that. So my mum gave me a few pointers of some things that she went through and kind of experiences she had with neighbours. So I went back and revised that section. So I definitely have. I've set myself a writing goal of nailing the description of Castleford. And through collaboration, I did that.
Yeah.
What about you, Abbi? Have you done your planner?
Yeah.
Task?
For my planner task, I did a lot of research on like how many poems a full collection is.
What is it?
Well, that's a great question. No one could really seem to decide from what I could decipher. It's kind of like in the range of, I think, 50 to 70 or 80 poems.
Gosh.
I believe. But she looks to the mic/camera. If anyone has any different ideas or opinions, please let us know, because it was a breadth of things. And I'm not going to lie, I felt quite overwhelmed by the thought of writing 50 to 80. And not even just 50, 80, I think we discussed before, not 50, 80 poems, but 50, 80 good poems that I've edited and gone through and like refined. So I kind of broke it down into like, I think I'd quite like to see it as like chapters and how many like chapters of verse that could be, or like smaller collections within, or how I'm going to tell a story basically.
Yeah, that sounds good.
To make it feel more attainable.
Sounds lovely to me. So you're going to have subheadings, you're going to have poems under subheadings.
Hannah's getting the list in her brain.
I love it. Yeah, you're going to organise all your things into collections and themes. Oh, nice. Well, yeah. I think that's when I was a couple of years ago, when I first started writing poetry, I was trying to draw various pieces into a collection. Mm-hmm. And that worked for me. I separated the collection up into sections and put these poems under the specific section they belonged in. So I think we were talking about this idea of when you're creating a collection, what do you do if all the pieces you've written aren't of the same theme or topic? Mm-hmm. That's a good way of kind of having multiple themes under one roof.
Yeah, finding kind of like a holistic, like almost like landscape of poetry rather than just like pinpointing on one thing.
Yeah, so that sounds good then.
Yeah, and then for Panzer, mm-hmm. mine was inspired by Andrew McMillan and the idea of like rather than writing about something, writing towards it. So for Panzers or that sort of umbrella term, it was about getting to like the real nitty gritty of your collection and then finding words and then writing towards those words and seeing how that kind of that direction took you. Mm-hmm. Which I've kind of done. Like, I'm not gonna pretend that I've had a lot of time to actually be really creative this week. I think I definitely got I figured out quite a few main themes of the collection, which is quite nice, and like kind of I feel like I've sort of got the, I don't want to say skeleton, I've got like the essence of what I want to get to, but yeah. I have not had a moment to breathe and be creative this week, which maybe after we've done recording today is the plan. Yeah. But that's the reality of creativity, and that's why we talk about this for us, because we both work full-time jobs. A lot of the guests we talk to and a lot of people in our community, the majority work full-time jobs, mm-hmm. and like you can't always do what you want to do or necessarily find the time for it.
Yeah, and I think that's it. It's not giving yourself a hard time about that as well. I mean, I've had a week off and I've done nothing. So, I mean...
But you need to do nothing.
Yeah, exactly.
You needed a rest.
But I would say that I actually have done the activity you're kind of describing there. I have done that before, but not this week where I've sat down with the intention of doing it. I've done it a lot in the past. And I think that's it, kind of thinking to yourself, okay, what do I want to achieve from this next section of writing? Mm-hmm. I want to get this, and this idea across. And then fleshing that out kind of thing. So, yeah, I think all of us have that idea in mind with this chapter, with this paragraph, what do I want to get across?
Yep.
How can I write towards that? Mm-hmm. So I think people will do that unintentionally without realising they're doing it. So...
Yeah.
I'm excited today to talk to Rosa. We're talking to a novelist today, aren't we?
Yes. Yeah, we're talking to Rosa Rogers, who was a Huddersfield local for a long time. Oh, I'm sure she'll introduce herself properly, but I've known Rosa a fantastically long time. She's wonderfully talented. And I'm just so excited to like have her involved in this, especially because she used to run a night here called Poetry Etc., which was very instrumental in how we structured Inkspill. But yeah, shall we talk to Rosa?
Hello, Rosa.
Hello.
So we are really excited to be joined by Rosa today. Rosa, would you like to introduce yourself, please?
Yes, of course. I'm Rosa, also from Huddersfield, the best place in the world. In terms of writing as well, like I feel like I owe a lot to Huddersfield. I first started writing in Huddersfield, first started performing in Huddersfield. But now I live down in Canterbury, which is nice, but there could be a few more open mics, if I'm honest. So I write and I also lecture in creative writing. But as you guys have talked about in your podcast, I'm still kind of learning like the process and my own voice as well.
The thing you haven't addressed, which is very cool, is I believe you're a doctor as well.
And yes,
that's what took you down south.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, I came for the University of Kent as well. The reason I came down, actually, they do a master's, a creative writing master's, split between Canterbury and Paris. And I do love like the proximity to Paris. Like you can get there just in, like 2 hours from here, which is amazing. And then I did the MA, and then I actually started a novel idea in the MA, which I wrote in kind of short stories then. And then in the PhD, turned that into a novel. As Abbi said, became a doctor last November, which is exciting. I'm still kind of overwhelmed. If a student says, Dr. Rogers, I kind of look over my shoulder.
Yeah, who's that? Oh, it's me. Oh, no, it's fantastic. Brilliant. That is the coolest thing to be able to say. They're like, oh, I can get to Paris in 2 hours.
Yeah, it's lovely. It is really lovely. And the PhD was great as well. That was in the contemporary novel. Hannah, I think you write prose. And actually, Abbi, I heard you write in a novel as well. So, yeah, it's really nice. And it's really, I guess, being close to London, being close to Paris, like, yeah, there's a lot of inspiration around, which is amazing.
So could you tell us a little bit more about the novel that you wrote as part of your PhD?
So it was quite interesting. My background's poetry as well. And I, during the MA, I wrote this really long poem. from the point of view which is now the mother in the story. And my tutor at the time said, this is a novel. This is not a poem, this is a novel. Which was quite daunting, because I thought, okay, how am I going to structure, like, what does that mean? How do I write this into a book? Years and years later, and about six drafts later, I have the novel. So it was called Composition, and it's all told from the point of view of a 12-year-old child called Celeste. And it's her coming of age story. She's kind of looking for meaning in a world that's complicated by adults. And she's quite playful, quite offbeat, but the people around her are very complex and complicated. There's a lot of family drama. I kind of explain it's like the stranglehold of family ties, and she's trying to navigate through this. And it's now actually called, in the final draft, Father Wound. And she's in the process of piecing together her identity, but also where she came from. And it takes her from Peckham in London above a pub to the west coast of Ireland, to Sligo, a farm in Ballymote. And she learns a lot about like family history, family secrets. And then at the end, yeah, I don't want to spoil the end, but it's an interesting, in terms of like coming of age, I'm very interested in, does anyone actually come of age, or is it like a sort of process and renegotiation?
That's great question. Fantastic. Yeah,
yeah.
I absolutely love the sound of that. That sounds brilliant.
Thank you.
So building on that, then, what are your biggest influences on your writing? Like, where is there like any particular authors that inspire you? Or
so many. Like, I saw that question, I thought, where do I begin? But I was kind of looking around my room just now, and I think the two people that I always come back to. Okay, three people. I'm going to do three that I always come back to. One's Lydia Davis, who writes flash fiction. I think she's her collection. I think there's Can't and Won't, and also just the collected stories. And anytime I just turn to a page, read one piece of flash fiction, I just want to write. Ali Smith as well. I think she's brilliant. And I think she kind of made me realize that I could write, because like the characters, they're very, I don't know, it's a bit offbeat, a bit playful, and it just made me think, okay, I can write a story in the way that I want to write it. And then Daisy Johnson as well. I think she's just incredible. I like her like kind of from a craft sentence, from a line by line sentence. And reading these three together has helped me like learn as a writer, but think about my own voice as well.
I mean, you've just named two of my favorite authors. I think that's I think you've chosen two really experimental authors, Ali Smith and Lydia Davis, really experimental authors, but also brave women kind of entering into this kind of discipline that has been very traditionally male led for so long, but they're kind of really taking the reins, aren't they? And just producing such groundbreaking stuff. I wrote a poem based on The 13th Woman by Lydia Davis, and I've never seen a woman write in such a way before, and I'm very inspired. So we've got very similar influences.
That's interesting. Yeah, it's almost like a breath of fresh air. You're just like, I can write like this. Like, yeah, it doesn't have to be in like the tradition of, as you said, quite male dominated like literature, but there's like there's more that you can do with the form. And
I have to say, when me and Rosa, we've been friends for like quite a long time, like any friendship pre-pandemic feels like it's a long friendship, but when we came to choosing guests, you were one of the first people I thought of, because just like I knew you two, like the Venn diagram is basically a circle with you two, so I'm really like enjoying this moment.
Well, I'm quite sad because I moved to Huddersfield. I think I just, because I'm sure we'll come to it, but Abbi was telling me about poetry, etc., and that I only came to Huddersfield during the pandemic, so it was 2020, so I feel like I just kind of missed out on some of the things that were happening pre-pandemic. And I think Huddersfield had some fantastic things, didn't it?
It still does. Like, it's sort of like the natural sort of phoenix style of creativity. Like, the other things go for other things to happen.
Exactly. And I love what you guys are doing as well. And it reminds me, ages ago, I did this like Tales of a Town thing in Huddersfield. And Elliot, one of the musicians that's kind of been around Huddersfield, likened like the kind of creative scene on Huddersfield too. I think it was like the Buddhist process of drawing like mandalas in the sand. And he said like the act of actually drawing them was enough in itself. Like, and I have been to like open mics in many different countries, and it feels like there's almost an end goal or there's a promotion. But like, I liked what Elliot said, because it's like I don't know, you go to one of these nights and you just experience this like amazing work, and it's in and of itself, which I think is amazing. And I definitely have to come to Inkspill as well.
You're very welcome anytime.
I can't wait. Yeah, I have to. I've not been to Huddersfield for a while. I have to. Yeah.
No, we are lucky. There is, as you say, a very supportive community here. And again, I think we found with Inkspill as well, just not having that end goal. It's just about celebrating a love of literature and a love of performing and sharing. I think that's what we've captured in Inkspill, definitely. And I think that's what makes it such a special place to hold an event of this niche, because everyone is just so lovely.
Yeah.
And there's such a thirst for it. So, I know what you mean.
Definitely, yeah.
Can I ask, because you mentioned a lot of novelists for your inspos, and I was just wondering how, like, poetry, because obviously, like, that's how we know each other, it just affects your, like, prose writing, and if there's any influences there.
Yeah, definitely. So I think, I find, like, being a poet first and then being a novelist later really helps, because I guess, the attention to detail, and I'm very interested in, like, scene by scene. It's been quite a lot to actually be like, okay, they need to now practically get from A to B. I just want to write the moments. Poetry is a huge influence. And actually, right at the beginning, so I studied English Lit in Lancaster, and I wasn't going to do creative writing, but I just went to one of the sessions, and they played Kay Tempest's Icarus, and I was absolutely blown away. I know it word by word. I wrote the whole poem down and read it out loud, and I just thought, oh my goodness, like, this is what, like, poetry and storytelling can do. Kay Tempest, definitely. Anne Carson, I think, is amazing. Her poem, The Glass Essay. So I think that's what I was firstly trying to do with the novel. So The Glass Essay is, like, a really long poem set kind of between Haworth. They've got, like, the Brontes, but it's also, like, quite contemporary. Like, there's a lot going on there. And I think that marks, like, my transition between poetry and prose, because there's, like, prose elements as well. I'm blanking with other poets right now, but yeah, and also music as well. Like, as you know, Huddersfield's got a huge music scene, and just going to see, like, bands like Extracurricular, I know this is really far in the past, but like Jack Flash and all of this, and thinking about, like, the lyrical quality, and even Jonas, and I think, yeah, my writing's so influenced by that, and, like, yeah, the rhythm of language, and it is a bit experimental, like, as we mentioned with Lydia Davis and Ali Smith, like, and I think I'm always aware of, like, the poetic qualities of language, but also trying to tell a good story at the same time.
I love what you said there in terms of language having that rhythmic quality, because it absolutely does. And I think I also feel the same way. I started with poetry, and then I naturally drifted, well, I started with songwriting, and then went from that into poetry, and then from poetry into novel writing. And I don't know if you feel the same way, but writing my novel, I always think about the way it sounds as well as the way it reads, if that makes sense. I think the sound can convey a lot of meaning as well. And I think quite often that's not something you associate with novel writing. But I do. I kind of try to put a bit of poetic flair onto the prose side of things as well. I just find it more enjoyable then to read if it sounds nice, if it flows well. I definitely don't think I'd have done that if I didn't start as being a poet.
Maybe I didn't realize that. I was in the library a few years ago with my friend, and she was like, can you be quiet? And I was like, what? And she was like, as you're typing, you're speaking. And I had no idea. So I was obviously, like, with the novel, like, actually, like, physically saying it out loud, and it was her saying it that has made me realize since then, like, I always do it. And I definitely agree. And when you have to, like, maybe stand up and read a bit out, then you can tell if something's not working, like, if the voice is, like, maybe inconsistent, like, reading it out loud gets you to hear the story in a different way as well.
Definitely.
I think, yeah. I
absolutely agree. That's brilliant. So we were kind of thinking about, well, we talked a little bit about where your initial inspirations come from. Maybe thinking about the latest piece that you wrote, maybe when you were creating that piece for your PhD, where do you begin when you're embarking on a creative project then, such as a poem or a book, a novel? Where do you begin? How do you start generating those ideas?
Yes, I've got a million thoughts in my head right now, but I guess one thing is, like, I'm very inspired, like, by real life, real experiences, real people, and, like, if something, like, moves me or makes me think about something differently, like, it sticks. I don't necessarily write about it instantly, but I do sometimes morning pages actually, and like I can tell, okay, these ideas, they keep coming up, there's something there basically to work on. And I feel like it like is always in the back of my mind, and if it kind of, I don't know, if I keep thinking about it, then there's something to write about. And sometimes, with like initial inspiration, it's always like images or feelings or emotions. And I'll write, I go on long walks, I'm always walking, and I always bring my phone and I write just in my notes app. And I've got so many, and they're like kind of moments. And then I think, okay, how might this be unpacked? And as I said, so the Father Wound, my current novel, it was very much just, I had this image of London and it was just someone walking by the river, and that's not actually in the book anymore. But I just felt like that character really came to life. And then there was this other scene. So it was initially from the mother's perspective. Now it's from the child's perspective. And I went to a cafe in Canterbury called Boho. I read a piece by Lydia Davis. And I was like, oh, that's really interesting. I can't remember what piece it is now. And then I just had this image of a child playing in the garden and a ladybird on her hand, and the ladybird fell off her hand. And it's a very small moment, but I wrote 6,000 words just there in the cafe. And I was like, that's it. That's the voice. And I was like, oh my God. And then I walked to the university. It was raining and my bag wasn't waterproof and my laptop basically broke. And I lost all of that. And I had a deadline that day where I had to submit the writing. And for a second, I was like, ah, for fuck's sake. And then I just thought, whatever, there's computers here. It's there. I'm going to redo it. So I just sat down and I wrote maybe 3,000 words. But like, interestingly, a couple of years later, I was able to restore those 6,000 words and they're almost identical. And yeah, and it's like, it's now the first scene like in the book, and as soon as I had that, I was like, right, I've got her voice, I know her way of seeing the world, she's interested in these like mini moments, animals and stuff, and yeah, it kind of went from there.
That's awesome.
That is brilliant, because I think I don't know if you heard in the first episode that we did, but Abby's just finished kind of the first draft of her novel. Yes. And so I think it's something we can all relate with. Finding that voice is, I think, the most challenging thing when you're approaching a novel, yeah, isn't it? Because I did a master's in creative writing, and I've said in the past I had to write the first third of a manuscript as part of the dissertation process. And I must have rewritten it about, honestly, 5 times, because I just couldn't get the right voice. And I'd find that as I was writing, that voice was changing to the point where you'd read the thing I'd just written and then you'd read the first page. And it was like a completely different person who'd written it, because I was just changing the voice so often, and it definitely was not identical. I would not have been able to do what you did there. And so that's fantastic that you managed to kind of do that, because oh God, we've said this before, I'd have a breakdown if my laptop broke, if my phone broke. I do not back things up enough. That is something I need to work on.
Yeah, it was horrible, but it took a few years. Like, it was like 2 years into the novel as well. Like, it wasn't early. And yeah, the mother's voice, I just couldn't get right, because she was kind of my age, but also a bit older. And I just, I just couldn't get the voice. And then there was something about Celeste and that morning, and I was like, that is her. So that really helped. She has kind of changed ages a couple of times, which was a bit difficult, but overall, yeah, I think her voice is there.
Which is fantastic. So, yeah. You said at the start, before we start recording, that you've listened to our introductory episode, which is lovely. And I think in that, and I think it's a thing we keep referencing, is planners and pantsers. And I would, I just love to hear from you. Are you a planner or a pantser? Like, do you think you found a way to be both? Like, how do you,
Yeah, I think this is such a good question and such an interesting idea as well. Like, I love the way you guys talk about it in the episode. And Abbi, I heard you were thinking a bit about structure at the moment. And I would love to say I was a pantser. I would love to say I just kind of see what happens, have a character, have a story, and then just go into it. But I'm not that kind of person, which is kind of frustrating. And once I tried to be that person, and so the first draft of my novel, so I had Celeste, had this opening. I went on a retreat to Ireland because I thought that's what writers do. I'm going to go on a writer's retreat. And I was like, I'm just going to see where she goes and let it happen. And then I wrote about 30,000 words over about 2 weeks, where she got abducted by fairies. And the she was taken to like this underworld. It was bonkers and it was terrible, like really bad. And it ended, like the novel ended, and I was so uneasy. I was like, what the hell just happened? So I got to the end and then I showed it to my supervisor and she was like, we're gonna have to get rid of those words. And I was like, yeah, I think so. I was like, don't know what happened. So I was able to take that away. There's still a sense of magic in the book because she's a child, but like it's not as like explicit. But yeah, and then in the second draft, I actually think there's a lot of like creativity with structure. And yeah, I got really into whiteboards. A weird thing to say, but in my office at the uni, there's a big whiteboard, and I thought I drew this big triangle and did like act one, act two, act three, act four, act five. And then I thought, okay, what could happen in these different moments? And then just having that foundation was really useful, and I actually found scene by scene, like it was playful, but like just having the overall structure, so having a sense of where it's getting to, was really useful. And I do that. So if I'm like knee deep in a project, the day before I write, I actually have an A3 sheet of paper and I like draw like the scenes that I'm going to write the next day, and just write like little images or something. And then the next day, I like put it on my wall and then like go through and do it. And I find it's really, really useful.
Yeah. This novel I'm working on has been sitting going since like 20, it's a pandemic. It was a pandemic project that got abandoned. But at uni and like privately, I've never done any study of like novel writing and structure. Like I was solely a poet. It was the only thing I felt I had the attention to like finish, and therefore it was like a source of real enjoyment for me. But novel structure is so interesting. Like I've been really looking at like a lot of like non-Western style story structures, which has been really interesting. I don't know if it's going to end up in my book, but it's just like it kind of took me away from like the 3 or 5 act structure and stuff, and stopped me from being like, oh, it must feel like this. This must be the pacing, which has been really exciting for me.
That is so exciting. There's a book called, I think it's Meander Spiral Explode. I don't know if it's all about, yeah, non-Western and non-phallic story structures, which I think is amazing. So it looks to kind of nature in terms of story structure. So there's like fractal story structures. And I do the triangle just because, so my supervisor Scarlett, she's like really interested in this. But then I thought within this, maybe there's space to do some of these other forms. And in Meander Spiral Explode, they kind of talk about the story structures that we've been doing. So it's like the build-up, the climax, the resolution, like kind of, I don't know, she talks about like the phallic kind of centric, phallosexual, I think that's what she calls it, the kind of up and then down. But then, yeah, I am interested in different story structures and what you can do, but it's interesting thinking how you can apply it when we've read so much that have been mimicking the other forms. Like, yeah, I guess like a poetic, or even she talks about structuring by colour or by sound or by image. Like there's different ways of, yeah, moving a story onwards.
That sounds really good. That sounds brilliant.
And very visual as well. I think a lot of people, there's a really funny image on social media that goes around, which is the start of Harry Potter, all the, wherever the film studio, logo, it gets darker each Harry Potter, and they use that as like this like really visual storytelling, and it's like a really accessible thing that a lot of people like reference in on it, like a sort of simple it's like a simple filmmaking image. And I think it's a really interesting idea of like structuring through color and like that, bringing that sort of visual into like into the written word. That was really well explained, apologies.
No, but I completely get that, like visual storytelling, and also like the echoing. Like I'm really interested in like, yeah, because you don't necessarily have to do this A to B and like clear cut, but you can cut between a scene and just have something that's like consistent, which could be like an image or a darkness, or yeah, I know it can be quite abstract, and if you're a writer you maybe feel it like a little bit more, but yeah, I think there is definitely something in that.
Yeah, I think it's this idea of motifs, isn't it? And having that motif line the text, and how that motif can develop as the text goes on. As an English teacher, because that's what I do as a full-time job, that's something that we always look at. And I think that's quite accessible for young readers, especially. How is that motif developing throughout, and what does that tell you about the character, the theme, the plot? And so I quite like, when I'm writing, I don't really have a structure in mind as to where I'm going to have these climaxes, where I'm going to have, where I'm going to build things. I just let the characters, I do plan. So and what you were talking about there was really resonated with me, because I have a whiteboard and I have, it actually looks a little bit like I'm doing a crime scene investigation sometimes, because there's lines, yeah, there's tape, there's all sorts going on. However, I need to know what I need to achieve, basically. It's kind of like what you were saying, splitting into achievable writing sessions almost, so that I don't go down these bizarre rabbit holes. But one thing that I always think about is this recurring image throughout, and I kind of just refer to them more as motifs. How am I going to use light, and how is light going to develop throughout? How am I going to use, yeah, just this particular object that keeps coming up? And for me, it's a newspaper, and how that gets passed from pillar to post throughout. And so I think, yeah, sometimes actually the image can be the structural technique as well, can't it? As well, yeah. Anyway.
Yeah, it made me think just when you were talking, I definitely have that, and I have light as well in my book quite a lot, but it made me think, just as you said, like in terms of structure, if you think I'm going to write like this huge epic three-part novel series or something, like you're never going to start. I love Anne Lamott's Bird by Bird. I know I've talked to Abbi a million times about it, and she kind of talks about this idea, take it bird by bird, like take it one step at a time. And she has on her desk like a small Polaroid, but like in the middle of the Polaroid it's kind of missing, it's like a little frame, and if she can't write, she'll just hold it up and just imagine just one scene or even one line of dialogue and just describe kind of what's in that small section. And then if you take it bit by bit or scene by scene, you're going to get to the end of the novel at some point.
Beautiful. I love that. Yeah. And I think that would work really well with because it sounds quite similar. I feel like we're working on pieces that have quite similar themes, and I think that's it, when you're trying to capture the people around you in real life, just actually looking up for a minute and just taking in what's in front of you, that can be quite inspiring if you're feeling a little bit lost, a bit stuck. That sounds like a great idea.
Definitely. I heard you say in the second episode as well, like even just looking out the window and thinking you're writing, like you sometimes you need that moment to step back and just think, and like, and then you can join the dots together in your mind as well, and just kind of trust that process as well.
Yeah, definitely. So like I love that technique, and it's really interesting. I think it's definitely something I will probably utilize more. But when it comes to overcoming stuff like writer's block, how do you do that? Is that a technique you utilize, or is there other elements that you draw on to kind of get the momentum going again?
Yeah, I think writer's block is a really difficult thing, and I think like at first you have to just give yourself a break, like or just not, I don't know, not criticize yourself too much, and not even think, because I think sometimes as writers we can, and especially with social media and everything, we think about either publishing or sharing, or like, oh my god, I'm not created something outwardly for a while. And I think we've got to kind of step back and think, why do I write? And not even like put pen to page or anything, just think for a while, like, why is it that I write? What is the reason? And like quiet all the outside noise. And then just think of practical techniques that you could do, like morning pages is so good. Like the idea with morning pages, you just wake up and...
Yeah, I was
just saying,
could you just clarify, sorry, morning pages, people who...
Yeah, so I can't remember, Julia Cameron, she wrote The Artist Way, and loads of different people have used this technique. So she talks about loads of stuff in this book, and it's all about living creatively. So it's not just being a writer, it's not producing constantly, but actually living creatively and trying to fit things into your schedule when you're quite busy. And one of the things is morning pages, which is like, so when you wake up, fill 3 pages with words. It can be anything. And the idea is that you don't actually think that I'm going to use these words again. It's just like, wake up, maybe set your alarm 10 minutes early and like just write whatever's on your mind, maybe what's coming up on the day, dreams. And the first 2 pages are terrible. Like it's just like stream of consciousness, whatever. And then always like on the 3rd page, well, not always on the 3rd page, but something happens, like your mind is kind of a bit stiller. And like you might start thinking about a story idea or a poem or something. And then through the repetition, you can like go back and see, like, as I said before, there's a few themes, like I'm really interested in mother-daughter relationships, for example, or different images, and like, and if that keeps coming up, then you can use that in your writing as well. And yeah, so slowly, and then like, I guess I go for walks, read books, listen to audiobooks, and then before you know it, hopefully, like you can't help but jot down little lines again and just slowly start building it up.
Yeah, that sounds very similar to something that we talked about quite early on in terms of always thinking that you need to have a chunk of time where you sit down and write, when in actual fact it's just stealing those little moments, isn't it? And as long as you're writing, that's something. And well, that's something that Abbi taught me, actually. No amount of writing is ever a waste or invaluable. Yeah. There's always value in whatever you produce. You can always come back to it. Because I was saying that my best friend is the backspace sometimes. I'll write something, I'll just get rid of it instantly. It's just what I'm like. I don't know why, but that, to me, yeah, that just seems like such a healthy way of going about it, doesn't it? And just stealing the odd moments that you get just to have that creative output.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I think that's really useful, and not putting too much pressure on it. Yeah, I love that. My best friend's the backspace. Yeah, that you know you can delete. And Anne Lamott actually says every month she has like an A4 textbook, like not a nice notebook as well, because if you've got a really nice notebook, you don't write anything as well. But she just fills one of them every month, and like sometimes it's awful. And it's nice as well talking, like as you're doing, like talk to different authors and see that like they struggle as well, and like, and they just write like a page and think, oh, that's perfect, I'm gonna publish that, but you have to realize like there's so much behind the scenes, and give yourself a break with it, I think.
Yeah, and humanize each other, because like, yeah. I really admire you, you've been a massive influence on my creativity, and just like real like yeah, it's as you say, you give me momentum, but you're always doing wonderful things, and you're always very generous with your time, and that's why I mean, appreciate chatting today and stuff. But like, there's a sign that I have in my room, and it's like, don't let your ice cream melt counting other people's sprinkles. And I think I've referenced it before, that's, and I'll reference song. It again.
Yeah.
Because I think as creatives, I went to 3 poetry events this week, and I was just like, oh gosh, everyone's fantastic, and they were phenomenal. Like I saw some incredible poets this week. And I'm just sat there going, why have I not writing? You know, I was performing poems that I wrote like last year and stuff. And I was like, why have I not got anything new and getting really in myself? And then I realised, well, you know, why am I worrying? Like, they're probably, we're all sat there comparing to each other and having these moments of like fear and doubt.
Yeah. It's inevitable, isn't it? I mean, I think that's it. When you're in a creative industry, you're always looking at other people. Mm. And I think that's it. It's being inspired rather than defeated by others, I think, because everyone's just, you know, we should celebrate each other rather than compare ourselves to each other, really, shouldn't we? But you said something that I thought is really important to remember just then, Rosa. I think you were talking about the fact that we all sometimes we jump the gun, don't we? We always think about the end product before we've even started the initial process of writing, and I think we straight away think, I want to get published, I want to perform this out and about.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the best piece of advice I ever received when I was doing my master's was, don't even think about getting that book out there until you've got a finished piece that you're really proud of, that you're completely behind, that you're really passionate about. Because I think we get so excited about getting it out there that we skip that point, don't we?
Yeah, we do. And like, and then if we send it out and we don't necessarily feel it's finished, that can be difficult as well, because you might get feedback that you know already, that maybe something's not working, and maybe you were already aware of that, but you're just quite desperate to get it out. It is extremely difficult, especially nowadays, like, and as Abbi says, with the competition as well. Like, I heard someone talk about like reframing jealousy as well, because it's like, it's not that you're jealous, it's that you know that's what you want to be doing. And I think like, knowing that, it can really motivate you. And I think it's great what you guys are doing as well, because I know with the podcast you're going to do writing activities and check in about your projects, and I think that can be really useful, like especially with a partner, because you can keep motivating and sharing, especially if your projects are slightly different. And I think that encouragement is key, and at writing events, because I have been to writing events where they can utilize like the competition as well and make people feel quite bad. And I don't think that that's horrible. Like, I know people that have gone to a writing event and just stopped writing like for ages because they receive one bit of critique. And I think, yeah, if you make the space, like as you guys are obviously doing, then yeah, everyone can kind of write together and keep like building on what they've done before. Yeah.
We were kind of talking about that, leads quite nicely onto our penultimate question, really. And we were thinking about this idea of, well, how long it takes to finish a piece. So in your experience, and it, well, it's quite different with you because obviously you've got the poetry side of things and then the novel writing side of things. How long does it take you then? Can we talk about the novel just because I'm genuinely interested? How long has that kind of taken you to complete that process?
My goodness, I don't want to count the years. It's the novel has been a very long time in the process. I think because like it's quite inspired by real life. So it's been quite interesting. Like it's not, I'm trying to think with the second novel, I'm going to write a pitch line and then I'm going to write the book. That's the idea. I'm going to like, who knows if that's going to happen. But with this one, I feel because I've lived it and I've been like working through it and also doing it as part of a course, it's been very different. And like at the beginning, so I've got so many sketchbooks as well that I started because I am quite visual, and I've got a sketchbook for each character and also a sketchbook for the story. And like I've got boxes and boxes of like clip-ins, or I've been to art galleries, taken photos, put it together. And I think the first year, year or so was just me getting my head around the idea. And then it's probably like 4 years of probably moving on to the fifth year now of like, doing it for the PhD and now doing it beyond the PhD. Because at first it was like, because there's some theory involved, like there's some psychoanalysis as well. Some boxes that I had to tick a little bit. And now like going beyond that with the book and doing the final edits and thinking a lot about the reader's experience as well. Because sometimes we can think, oh, I'm going to write this beautiful scene, but you have to write it for the reader and think about what you've set up. And I'm at the point as well where I've got to kind of emphasize some of the key moments, like in terms of pitching and selling and everything as well, but doing it from a place that feels real to the story. I found in the kind of final editing, I've just kind of got really deep on the main themes, and because I know it so well, that's been really fun to do. I know there's not a real time scale. I hopefully, touch wood, the second book would be quicker, because like I think the first time you're like figuring out how to write a novel.
Definitely. Do you think your find the line between, because you say it's based on some real life stuff and then obviously creativity, you find the line where you're writing for both yourself and for the reader, like, because obviously there's some stuff that, I mean, everyone to a certain degree processes our own stuff through our writing, but then when you're looking to create something to share with people, how are you finding that balance?
That kind of is a really good way of putting it. And I think what I was trying to explain there but wasn't able to explain a little bit, because I think at first it was me telling me the story and figuring out both something from life but also how to tell a story as well. Like it's not completely from my life. It began there, and then I got characters, and then those characters like took it away. But then in the editing, that's where I've really thought more about the reader, definitely. And that's been quite good, because now I'm sitting back and being like, okay, this is the story that I'm telling. How can it be the most compelling for a reader? And there are some detective elements as well, and that's been quite fun to think, okay, when shall I reveal this, and that's when I've also like kind of had the big board and like I've thought, okay, so here this is revealed, and just trying to really amp up the tension. And I've definitely done that in the final edit in stages.
It might be quite interesting, because we have said, the whole point of this podcast is that we're going to do 4 seasons, and each season is going to be on an aspect of the writing process. Mm-hmm. So this is getting started and kind of getting that project underway. And then the next season is all about editing, isn't it? And we both kind of said that's something as writers we don't prioritise, and that we need to really put emphasis on, because it can completely transform your work, can't it? And because like you say, that's the second that it's almost taken away from us as writers, and it's put into the perspective of the reader instead. And when you kind of, I was having a conversation with somebody at Inkspill last night, and we were talking about the fact that you feel you've communicated something so clearly there, and it's amazing when somebody else reads it and does not get that same message. And I think that editing process, it completely transforms your piece, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah. The best thing is when you write something and someone reads it and takes a better meaning than you give, or like pointed out like another hidden meaning. My partner actually does that all the time. He's like, it was really cool when you did that. And I was like, oh yeah. And then I'd have to go back and I guess edit it. Like I kind of like that idea of refining, like it's almost like you're chiseling an idea that's there, because at first like you overwrite it, it's kind of like blah, like word vomit, like you get all down, and then what the editing can do is really just like, yeah, peel away the layers. There's a quote that I really like that's like, you write with your heart and then you edit with your head, which I think is quite true, but you still need to keep the heart. Like I don't think you should over edit as well, but I know this is for the next podcast.
No, but it's good food for thought, isn't it? I guess.
Yeah, yeah. I have to say I really liked it. Was just in your previous answer where you were like, I wrote for myself and then I edit for the reader. Yeah. And I like that as almost like translating. I think that really resonates with me, is the fact that yeah, I am writing, especially this novel, I am writing for myself, but then having other people read it, I'm like, translate this.
Yeah, exactly. And what's kind of cool as well, because if you do, because it's not that you're only writing for yourself as well, because I'm interested in how writing, like if you write something that feels true, someone else is going to connect to it. But it's just like, we've really got to think about how do you write that truth, and it takes a long time, and it's like, yeah, piercing like these things that you maybe you've thought about for ages. But it can come out like a little bit messy at first, and then yeah, as you say, you can go back and be like, this is what I meant here. Yeah, I guess writing inspired from life, one exercise I really like is, so there's a novelist, American novelist called Joe Brainard, and he wrote this whole book, you might have heard it, and it's all repeating the refrain, I remember, I remember, I remember. I've definitely used this in teaching, and it's quite a good writing exercise to just like, I don't know, set a timer for 5 minutes and just write a list, I remember, I remember, I remember. And yeah, have you used that one before?
I haven't.
Yeah,
the hands
are doing it. It's really good. Yeah. I know exactly what you mean. That's a fantastic one. So is that what you'd kind of suggest, sitting down and just delving into those memories?
Yeah. And just like letting, like we've talked a bit about stream of consciousness, just letting the thoughts come in. And then if there's anything you want to take further at the end, there might be a sentence or two that could then, you could get rid of the I remember and then just write a scene, like bring one of the memories to life.
Last question before we love you and leave you, and it's a biggie, so that's why we send you in advance, because I think everyone has a crisis when they're asked, what is your favorite book?
Yeah, I love that question, but it's also very difficult, and I think I'm gonna have to go with like a book that I've actually just been teaching last week, because it's really in my mind, and it's Rebecca Watson's Little Scratch. I love this book. Actually, Hannah, I know you mentioned Virginia Woolf, and so this novel, it starts at the moment that an unnamed narrator wakes up, finishes at the moment she falls asleep, and it basically tracks all her thoughts in a single day. Not every single thought, obviously, but like, kind of through her process, there's the conscious thoughts, the unconscious thoughts, and that it's actually laid out in different kind of places on the page. So we've got kind of what she's doing, the conversation she's having, but then like the second guessing she's having, like the funny thoughts, and there's a lot, it's a really interesting like exploration of the mind, but also the mind, like I don't want to ruin it, but something has happened to her which she's attempting to repress, and as you go through, you kind of, there's glimpses of, okay, there's something unsaid here, why is she kind of trying, she kind of performs for ease, like she's performing a version of herself, but there's definitely something underfoot. And it's just fascinating. It's really interesting. So I was teaching these American third year students, and I got them to read it like simultaneously, the text on the page, and they were like, what? Like they didn't understand. Not they didn't understand, but they were like, I've never read anything like this, because it's experimental. But you spend a bit of time with it, and it's just like, it really gets under your skin. It's like, it's really amazing. It kind of says the things we think but never say as well.
And you know, I love that as well. When you get a really experimental piece of literature and you just think, I have no idea what's going on here, but I love it. I love being lost, because that sounds fantastic. And I think that's one of the reasons why I had I read James Joyce's Ulysses, and I love that take on writing, because it's almost as though words are on the paper before they've even entered the character's mind. And I just think that's a really interesting way of going about the writing process. And yeah, I love exploring the depths of a character. And I love the idea of these repressed thoughts coming through and they're just leaking into the prose. I think that sounds brilliant.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, writing and psychology are a really interesting crossover, I think.
What was that called again, sorry, the text?
It's called Little Scratch.
Little Scratch? Yeah. I'm shocked I've not heard of that.
Yeah, it feels a very you book, as Rosa was explaining.
It does, but anyway, it's another one to add to my reading list.
Yeah, you've given us amazing recommendations today, so I'll be compiling that for our listeners.
Amazing. Yeah, just message me if you want like any spellings or anything like that.
That would be fantastic. Thank you so much, Rosa, for your time and everything, really. It's just been a fantastic conversation.
Yeah. It's been brilliant. Thank you.
Rosa, phenomenal.
Absolutely brilliant. I am just loving what we are doing so far. Just every conversation I've had, well, we've only had two, and I'm already like, I need to go right this very minute.
It's doing exactly what we wanted it to do.
Yeah.
And that is getting to sit down with other poets and actually have conversations and time with them, because often when we're hosting or when we're at events, you're so rushed to kind of interact with people and tell them how good they were because they're phenomenal and make sure you swap contact details that you never kind of get the moment of like, tell me about your craft, tell me about how you spend time, tell me how you write, how you get going. And also like, I mean, you did the masters, but for us, both of us, it's been a while since we've kind of like learned writing. Mm-hmm. It's so nice having that almost like instruction come back to us and like that structure of someone telling us how they do stuff.
And as well, I'm finding it quite reassuring to know that we're speaking to people who are very, very experienced writers.
Yes.
And they're also facing similar challenges to me, and also they've got quite similar processes to me, because that helps me realize I'm actually on the right track. And I think that's really reassuring, and I hope that anybody listening to this podcast kind of feels the same way.
I say, it humanizes us all. All these incredible people that we surround ourselves with and enjoy their work, they're all just like us. We're all just getting on with life.
We're all just trying our best. But yeah, really good. And I'm loving as well all these recommendations coming through for books and authors that I've never even heard of.
We will list those on our social media to help people, because, I mean, Rosa was just a fountain. Like,
she was a fountain of knowledge.
A source of just endless recommendations. I know your eyes just lit up every time she spoke, which is fantastic.
I know. I was just saying, I feel as though Rosa was a little bit of my spirit animal, and I've never even met her. It's like, are you me?
Yeah, you just mirrored each other.
God, everything she was saying, I was just like, me too. And it was getting a bit creepy at one point, so I had to be quiet, because
it was great, because I'm just sat there going like, I have melded my worlds, because I just knew you two would get on. Like, it's so reassuring. Really, really, I was just like, these two creative types are, the Venn diagram is a circle.
Yeah.
So
really good. But we need to now set our creative task for the weekend, don't we? Because obviously that is the goal here. We need to be setting ourselves tasks so that we actually do our project.
Yeah. Should we start with Rosa?
Yeah. So Rosa obviously talked about the fact that her work connects with the real world, life around her.
Yes.
And I think you could be writing a fantasy novel, you could be writing a historical novel, but you still need to connect with the world.
You could be writing anything. Yeah, it needs to
there's always
going to
be that element of connection, isn't there, with the people and the spaces around you. So I think Rosa recommended an activity called I Remember, and it's something I've done before as well when I've been doing this for
Masters. I've never heard of it, and I was like, sounds right up my alley.
It does really help if you just want to get the cogs turning a little bit, if you've got a little bit of writer's block as well. So you literally just, with a pen and paper or a laptop, and you just keep delving into those memories. Start every sentence with, I remember, I remember, I remember, I remember. And just like what Rosa suggested, you could just knock off I remember and then take one of those sentences, one of those ideas, and run with it, basically. That can become a character or a chapter or a paragraph. But yeah, those memories help with this, what we call horizontal and vertical storytelling. So the horizontal is your plot, and that's very much, and then this happened, this happened, this happened. But then you have that vertical, and it's that moment where you just delve into that character. Mm-hmm. Might be a memory, it might be a flashback, it might be just something about their character. And that I remember task is really good for that, because it helps give you that your story that vertical if you feel like it's getting a little bit too plot driven.
No, I love that. I think I want to do this, but I am a very emotional person. I think I want to add a caveat to this of just like, if you do engage with this, make sure you give yourself time to kind of come away from it afterwards.
Yeah.
Because the issue with writing, and especially this kind of exercise, it will dredge up a lot of stuff, and that can be great or it can be difficult. Mm-hmm. And often I think sometimes we forget that the end of writing, we kind of need to like almost like walk ourselves gently back into the real world.
That's
and like
a very,
not
very good point.
Just be like, right, and we talked about taking any second we can, but I think with stuff like that, it would be good to set aside like 10-15 minutes of just, you can then like warm yourself back up into like getting on with the day.
That decompression will be, if you've
love that word, yes,
delved into some pretty deep memories,
yeah,
to decompress, definitely.
Yeah, you do. So.
Because I
love
think
that.
That's the kind of task as well that starts out quite surface level and gets quite deep quite fast.
Yeah, you can sort of fall down a mine shaft with it.
Yeah, yeah. So definitely, I've loved that suggestion from Rosa.
Yeah,
what's fantastic. Your Pantser.
I love the book that she mentioned, and I was just thinking about it, and I was like, Morning Pages as a crossover between Pantser and Planner, like the Planner of setting that time aside, but the Pantser of just kind of seeing where it goes. Mm-hmm. But instead of doing morning, I believe the sort of set for Morning Pages is normally just literally in the morning, you're in your bed or at your coffee table, whatever. But instead, taking Morning Pages out into the real world and maybe going to a coffee shop or sitting in the library, mm-hmm. or on the bus, and you know, putting your noise cancelling headphones on, but something where you're still out in the real world and you use that setting as inspiration for your Morning Pages.
Yeah.
So it could be a barista, it could be people shopping and buying stuff, or like the fight over the last pastry or something like that, or just commuters waiting for the bus and cramming on. Doesn't really matter, but like taking those Morning Pages and just looking at the world around you and using that as a moment of like inspiration. That's
yeah.
my idea.
And I think Rosa said 3 pages.
Yes.
So because your first 2 pages are inevitably going to be a little bit
rusty, rubbish.
Rusty, yeah, but yeah. by your third one you should get into the swing of it. So
Absolutely.
If you can do 3 pages, I think that's a good goal.
Mm-hmm.
If not, no pressure. You're writing, you're taking that time to explore your creativity. And
yeah,
you know, I think
absolutely
that should be applauded as well.
The thing I want to say before we ask you your planner one is just to quickly say, do not delete them.
Oh,
do
sorry,
not delete
yes.
your first 2 pages. Do
yes.
not go back. Just keep going forward, because it's something I'm working on with Hannah. and I appreciate it's not easy. But do not use a backspace in these Morning Pages. Do not yeah. cross stuff out. Do not, you know, anything. Just leave it alone,
mm-hmm.
because you aren't wasting anything. That is your foundation on which you're building your writing.
Yeah.
And like, just keep going forward.
It's very true. And message taken. I will not delete. I will keep it all there.
It wasn't to be that pointed.
No, I do need to do that, because I need to stop. I think I do it more as a bit of a punishment to myself.
Yeah.
So I think, yeah, keeping it is always going to be better. And I know that. I think I just, I'm a very impulsive person. And yeah, I need to stop being so cutthroat, I think.
Yeah.
So the planning, within me, the planning task for this week, I really loved what Rosa was talking about in terms of visuality and writing, because I think mm-hmm. the two go very, they go hand in hand. We talked about using Pinterest and using social
yes,
media to
love that.
Your advantage in terms of inspiration. I think keeping a scrapbook and actually mapping out your
yep.
novel within this chapter, this is the vibe, and kind of, you know, if it's drawing pictures, if it's just getting quotes from magazines, if it's,
mm-hmm.
You know, just gathering things from day-to-day life.
You can even
a bit
have,
of
like,
mood board.
Smells and foods.
Yeah.
Like, the olfactory sense is very
Absolutely.
The strongest sense.
All of this kind of this stuff. I mean, we talk about using sensory imagery in writing because it is supposed to be an immersive experience. Thinking about the reader, we need to put them in that moment as well, don't we?
Yeah.
So we need to make sure that we are creating that immersive experience, and I think visuality and evoking those senses is the best way to do that.
I love
so
that.
Yeah, scrapbook, get yourself a notebook and just really try to map out,
or do it on Pinterest if
yeah.
you can't, you know, it sounds silly, but people don't have printers anymore, really.
It's true. Pinterest, A3 paper as well, if you just want to draw, or
magazines, get
yeah.
back into collaging,
do a PowerPoint presentation,
whatever.
I've done that before.
Yeah.
But whatever works for you. Yeah, just try to visualize your novel now, see it through a different lens and see where that takes you.
I love that. Well, thank you very much, Hannah, for another sparkling time together.
Yes.
Next week, we will be with Dwell Time, who are a charity
yeah.
based in Huddersfield.
So if you listen to our introductory episode, episode, you will know that we are going to prioritise one episode per season that is going to be dedicated to mental health. And Dwell Time are a mental health publication based in Huddersfield, so they're very local.
Mm-hmm.
I am so excited to speak to them to kind of figure out how that came about. And yeah, just kind of get the inside knowledge from them as to how creative writing really does benefit your mental health. Because I think we all know it, but it'd be nice to hear some experiences of how it has helped people in our local community as well.
Yeah, it's going to be really exciting. Thank you so much again to Rosa for spending that time with us. Thank you for joining us. And yeah, we'll see you next week.
Have a nice week.
Bye.